got the papers and the cash.
So you saw yesterday I was in a Twitter fight, Bernie, with Jamel Hill. Jamel Hill wrote this story yesterday about the Boston Red Sox going to the White House.
Formerly of ESPN, the African-American female.
She's a racist.
Columnist.
Right. And she writes this story, why don't more white players respect their black teammates and basically boycott, not go to the White House, do these events? So that was just me with Jamel Hill yesterday. And it's very, very similar to what the great Bill O'Reilly wrote about hate masquerading as virtue. And with Tiger Woods and Donald Trump, he's always been the best. He still is the best. He'll always be the best. There's nothing like BillO'Reilly.com. Great articles, great interviews, great TV, great videos. And we are very fortunate to have the great Bill O'Reilly on this program every time this week. Here he is, the great Bill O'Reilly. Good morning, Bill.
Sid, how are you doing, man?
I'm doing great, pal. Nice to have you back.
Big and Bill.
The fight yesterday that I had with Jamel Hill, very, very similar to what you're talking about with Tiger and Donald Trump, which is that the newspaper, the Baltimore Sun, like her, expects white people to start hating Donald Trump like black people do.
Well, number one, I reject the fact that African-Americans hate Donald Trump. I don't think that's true. I don't think that there is one feeling one way or the other. The second thing is, what disturbs me about this is that the anti-Trump forces see themselves as virtuous. So they're saying to Americans, well, he's terrible, Donald Trump, because we don't agree with him, and he's got to go. And by us saying that, we're virtuous. We're good, noble people. Yet, they can't stop by just saying we want him to go. They have to hate him. And then they have to hate anybody who associates with him, i.e. Tiger Woods. That was my point. So let me ask you guys, is hatred virtuous?
Well,
is that a new virtue in America? Hatred?
Apparently, to some people.
Because it's acceptable.
Yeah.
For the Baltimore Sun, the other newspapers, the television outfits, you know who they are. It's acceptable for every single day to come in and say, this guy's the devil, he's a racist, he's a bigot, he's whatever the smear du jour is, but we're virtuous. You know, it's really, it got to the point, it is absurd, it's a carnival of absurdity. But there's something deeper now, because they're trying to divide Americans by saying that if you support Donald Trump, or even give him a fair shot, then you yourself are a bad, evil person. That's what's happening.
That's right. And they suffered, these people, with their misleading narrative, they suffered a little bit of a setback. And, of course, you, Bill O'Reilly, are writing a book, a biography of Donald Trump right now. So this whole Charlottesville thing, it turns out that the fact that he's, or the misleading notion that he said that the Nazis, there are some good people amongst Nazis, not true, not true whatsoever, really setting them back a lot, because that's what they always fell back on, was the Charlottesville's canard to paint this guy as a racist.
But McGurk, they're never going to admit that. In a million years, Jamel Hill or any of the other haters, and I believe she is, will never say that Donald Trump's intent was not to glorify Nazis. They will never do that. So that's one of the reasons I decided to write The United States of Trump, because I my head was blowing off here, and I said, look, I got to write a history book based on reality and facts. And we do get into the Charlotte thing very deep. You'll see. And the way I do it is so clear, and there's no two sides to the story. We'll present you with the facts. You know, I got a kick out of the New York Times bombshell that they finally figured out in the 80s and 90s the Trump Organization lost a lot of money. Well, who did not know that?
Right. Yeah, right.
And I'll break a story on your show today. It's a lot more than $1 billion that they lost.
Yep, sure.
A lot more.
Yep. All which he acknowledged himself.
Well, it doesn't make any difference, because that is what business That happens in business. But the story is, the incredible story is, how he got out of it.
That's right. The comeback.
Mm-hmm.
25 years later, worth a couple of billion and the leader of the free land.
So when you see this stuff, now I'm not saying the New York Times should write a story about Donald Trump's comeback. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying that once people read the whole package, how he got into trouble financially and how he got out, it's a fascinating look at the mind of the president of the United States, both good and bad. But you don't get that.
No, you really don't.
You know?
Nope, you don't, Bill O'Reilly. And you know, I often wonder this. I didn't vote for Donald Trump. I didn't particularly like him. But I've done a complete 180. Complete 180. I like him a lot. I like what he stands for, and I can't stand the other side. And I think people like Bernie and Trump, for that matter, they want to know about more and more examples of me because that's going to make Trump's life easier in the election in 2020. So my question to you is, am I one of the rarities, or do you think there are more and more Sid Rosenbergs every day?
Well, I hope there are not more Sid Rosenbergs, number one.
Just generally speaking.
I mean, how much more can we take?
Well, he teed that up.
Right. Oh, that's very good.
That's beautiful.
But your question is, how many independent thinkers are there?
Yeah.
So if you look at the polls, if you do the polling, about 60% of Americans are committed to an ideology, all right? Most of them are conservative, and about 25% hardcore liberal. The rest of the people are divided into two camps, those who don't know anything. And I know we all know people like that. They don't know anything, and they don't care. They don't care. All right? So those people, you're never going to reach. Maybe they'll vote if you give them $20 and put them on a bus, maybe. But they don't care. The others are either distracted or confused, because Donald Trump's a pretty definitive guy. If you don't know by now whether you like him or not, then, you know.
I mean, come on.
But you got to decide whether you're going to vote on a motion, well, I like him or I don't, or you're going to vote on what you believe is good for the country. So when you have a record-breaking economy that's benefiting millions of Americans, and when you have a foreign policy that pretty much wiped out ISIS, I mean, those are two pretty big things. So, you know, to answer your question, I would say maybe there's 15% that are what I call persuadable on either side,
yeah,
and that those people will decide the election 2020.
And to your point, Bill, of course, the economy and foreign policy all successful, which is why the Democrats are just losing their minds in Congress. They don't know what to do, so they're attacking this attorney general. But we are out of time, Bill O'Reilly, sadly. I would just say this. Go to BillO'Reilly.com for more of this brilliant insight, and also to pre-order Bill's new book, The United States of Trump, BillO'Reilly.com. Bill, thank you very much.
Okay, guys. Always fun to talk with you.
Us too.
A pleasure.
Love you, Bill. Thank you. The great Bill O'Reilly here on the Bernie and Sid Show.